It's not just ICE raids. A new report exposes how companies breed fear among low-wage workers through illegal retaliation against those who try to stand up for their rights. In Illinois, it wasn't big labor, but an alliance of community-based workers' groups who compiled a report. In Chicago, I had a chance to hear more from Sophia Zaman, alliance organizer.
Raise the Floor is, I would call it, right, the next step in the worker center movement. And so worker centers have been around for about the past decade, and they sort of emerged to respond to the changing nature of our economy, in which, you know, multinational corporations are moving freely across borders, jobs are getting outsourced across seas, and the work here that's available is low-wage, low-quality positions. And the people who usually occupy those jobs are immigrants, people of color, and other communities of color. And unfortunately, those folks, those communities, have always been on the margins of sort of strong unions core. And I say that as someone as a former union organizer with a lot of love. But there's just sort of cultural nuances and cultural barriers, right, to participating in traditional labor movements. And so worker centers emerge to respond to this crisis of our economy and a crisis of the labor movement. And so in Chicago, there are 8 worker centers that are organizing across various low-wage industries, anything from restaurant and retail to warehousing and manufacturing, domestic work and cleaning, day labor, and formerly incarcerated workers who are experiencing their own barriers. And Raise the Floor's purpose was sort of to unite these 8 worker centers around shared issues that all low-wage workers are experiencing, issues of wage theft or discrimination or unsafe working conditions and retaliation. In Chicago, we have a thriving worker center movement. There are actually 8 worker centers that span across geography and industry. So some worker centers are organizing by neighborhood, like Southeast Chicago, where there aren't a lot of resources. Some worker centers are organizing by identity, like the Worker Center for Racial Justice, which is organizing returning citizens, formerly incarcerated workers. And some worker centers are organized by industry, like the Chicago Workers Collaborative that's organizing in the temp staffing industry, or the Warehouse Workers for Justice, or Rock Chicago, Restaurant Opportunity Center. And what's so unique about Raise the Floor is that this is the first time that worker centers have come together in this kind of, not just coalition, but alliance. Chicago is so important to the economy because it's actually the logistics hub of the country. So while most products may be made in China, for example, they have to go through either the Port of Los Angeles or the Port of Oakland and then get on a train. And the only way to get to the East Coast is you have to go through Chicago, because Chicago is where all the railroad tracks converge. And so, in fact, Chicago has a booming logistics industry that requires factory jobs and manufacturing jobs to meet this demand. Companies like Target, Walmart, Amazon, the companies that you use every day with a booming digital economy that you can get your goods in 2 days, the 2-day shipping comes in at an expense, and it's usually at the expense of a worker. Any kind of abuse you can think of, we captured it in our report. One story that really struck me is Victoria, right? She works at a pizza factory in Romeoville, Illinois, right? Interesting location, a lot of warehousing and logistics industry, big boom there. And Victoria was working at this frozen pizza factory, putting ingredients onto the pizzas and then building the boxes. And this is a pretty standard job in the Chicago area, manufacturing job, factory job. And the motion of putting the boxes together and the motion of putting the ingredients on the pizzas, right? You're just doing the same repetitive motions all day. And so naturally, your wrists would start to deteriorate. This is just, it comes with the work, right? And so Victoria went to the doctor because she was experiencing pain. And the doctor said, well, you can no longer do this kind of work, otherwise you'll have permanent damage to your wrists. So Victoria went to her floor manager, and she shared this information. When she had the doctor's note and said, I'm experiencing pain, I need different work. And so the boss called her worthless. The boss said, you are disposable. We're gonna put you in isolation because you can't do the work that we need, so whatever, like, go. And they put her in isolation in the frozen section, and they didn't warn her. She didn't even have warm clothes. And so she was put in isolation because she complained. And then when she complained about the isolation, she was fired. Right? So you see this sort of escalation from being called worthless, that your opinions don't matter, that your labor is invaluable, to being put in isolation so you can't organize with your coworkers, to straight up being fired. These practices aren't legal, and there are laws on the books that demonstrate such, but and worker centers have been part of the front lines to win a lot of these policy changes, but ultimately, if workers can't claim those rights, if they can't stand up for their rights, then it just becomes a piece of paper and of no use to the lived experiences they have on the ground. So there's a current organizing campaign happening at a factory called IFCO that is a distributor for Walmart. And they produce pallets that ship the groceries from the factory to the grocery store. And these factories are, unfortunately, it's just one story of hundreds, but the conditions are terrible, right? Workers are packing these pallets, standing up to their ankles in feces because the sewers have overflown. They don't have access to training or health and safety equipment, and so they are operating chemicals and inhaling them unsafely. And they are operating machinery that's being asked to shove their hands into machinery that's still moving, that has the potential to chop off their arm, but you gotta get that 2-day shipping, and so you gotta move as fast as you can. The nature of the industry is that in order to compete, you have to break the law, right? You have to build wage theft into your business model. You have to build in unsafe working conditions into the business model to stay competitive. And so the way to keep competitive and the way to break the law is to develop a culture of fear so that workers can't come forward or don't feel comfortable coming forward to stand up for their rights. And so we see it every day. It's the biggest barrier to organizing, and it's the biggest barrier for workers to stand up for their rights. So for us, until we address workplace retaliation, we can't fully impact any other issue area. So in this particular moment where we see that union density is on the decline and that this culture of fear is just permeating every workplace, we need an organization that can hold space for the trauma that workers are experiencing. We need organizations to have the kind of slack that's required to test new membership models, to test new organizing campaigns. The exciting thing about Raise the Floor is that it sort of gives that added capacity so that worker center organizers can focus on what they do best, which is organizing, so that they have access to any components that you would need for any strong campaign, like a research shop that demonstrates why we need change, like a communication shop that centers the voices of workers and elevates their stories in the media. Like a policy shop that can have a presence at the Capitol and can make sure that workers are being centered in all of their discussions about policy change. I think that worker centers alone cannot meet the scale of abuse that we know exists in these kinds of industries, but we need government agencies to formalize these relationships and fundamentally recognize that in a complaint-driven model, you need community partners and you need workers. At the Worker Center Movement, we fundamentally believe that workers are the experts of their own lives and they should be the ones driving the policy solutions that they need. And so we believe that any enforcement change, any policy change needs to center their voices, their experiences. And in addition to that, we sort of see three key ingredients, the first of which, of course, is workers and the tacit knowledge they carry of their workplaces and industries. But the second is community partnerships, that worker centers in particular are trusted community organizations that are in the community, they share language, they share cultural nuances, and they build deep, deep trust. The kind of trust you can't get by just telling a worker, go show up at this government building downtown, take a train, show ID at the front door. That's not a very trusting environment. You need an organizer with you who will make you understand of your own sense of your own power, that you are the expert of your own life and you know what you need and you know that this practice is illegal, right? And so it's up to you to stand up for those rights and feel confident that you know what justice looks like and you're going to achieve it. As worker centers, we engage individuals in their role as workers, but we fully recognize them as whole human beings beings that are part of particular neighborhoods or part of particular racial or ethnic groups and part of particular religious institutions. And we aren't just fighting to improve the material conditions. So that's certainly important to us, but ultimately, organizing is about altering the relations of power. It's about helping our communities understand that we are the source of everything we need. And we dream of a democratic, joyful, beautiful workplace in which workers have dignity and respect, and that they are the ones who are centered in our work and not profits.